You know what? I will
Yeah.
be recording it now and I can send it to you later.
Oh, I'm fine with, I can do interview with both. That's actually much better than Jacqueline. I'm Muskan Sharma and I'm a third year fashion student in Pearl Academy, which is in Delhi. So our college project is Fashion of Resistance, where how you're resisting some belief through fashion garment or through any fashion accessories. I got your contact through Aruna ma'am. She was one of my teacher and she's a close friend to my mom. So she told me about your wedding and how it was and how ma'am was invited. So I was very interested in knowing how you face a lot of difficulties and how people reacted to your wedding, or how the community, LGBTQ community, is still not really accepted in the Indian society. So through that, I would like to ask you guys some questions.
Sure.
What are the basic belief of your identity?
What is that?
I identify as an asexual and agender person. And sure.
And I identify as a homosexual male or a gay male.
Okay. And then what is this what are the strong belief or what do you strongly resist on? Like the belief we have?
This time.
Yeah.
Well, I think my belief is that the fundamental right to self-determination is something that is granted to every individual by the Constitution. And by that right, by the fundamental right of self-determination, I can decide how I want to carve and express my identity in society, and I cannot be penalized for my beliefs and my rights. So that's essentially the fundamental belief with I operate, and yeah, that's mine. What would be yours?
Just to behave a certain way, to perform the roles of either of the genders without being judged.
Yeah.
So I shouldn't be called a female for doing household chores. Shouldn't be called a male because I am the one who is working and earning some money.
Yeah.
In the specific roles, I have to resist that.
That's a nice way of saying it, because there is a difference between gender roles and gender identity. And while I might identify with a particular gender or lack of it, I should not be pigeonholed into a particular gender role simply because I am a male or a female or a transgender or a trans person or an agender or asexual or gay. None of these things should determine my role in the larger view of the society.
Yeah, definitely. And what is the pathway or the tool chosen by you, and like what and why, how did you come across this? Like being in Indian society, how we face a lot of difficulties, and being also in a fashion college, I've seen a lot of my friends facing so many problems being in whether they want to know that what is their identity, because as of now we don't really know what we are and we've not discovered what we actually want to be. So like how did you choose this path, as in like when did you get to know that I would want to come out to the world and show that this is my identity and this is whom I want to be?
Okay, so I, in my case, I know that I am fine with any gender specific symbolism associated. Yeah. So I know I'm okay being very girly and being very masculine. Like, I'm fine either way. To me, these are all just ways to maneuver, express, dramatize, emote our communication, you know, how we talk and how we communicate. So I don't really ascribe to one as much. However, I feel the most comfortable in the masculine role simply because I find it more convenient. So it's less to do with me wanting to wear flowy clothes or wearing makeup. I just find that attentiveness to detail very tedious. So it's so for me, it's a personal choice because of that. You know, yeah. I would much rather not worry about what I wear and how I dress, and instead focus all my energy on what I do. And yeah. I would like my work to be an expression of who I am as an individual, not what I wear, not how I dress, not how I talk, not how my hairstyle is. So therefore, I all of these things neutral, and I focus more on my work. So that's how I, so it's not so much a resistance in my case, it's actually the opposite of resistance. It's too easy for me to be, I want to make it easy for other people to look at me and then immediately jump to what I do. Instead of being so either enamored or so inhibited by my dressing style that it takes away from what I do. I don't want my work to be colored by my identity. I want my work to stand for what it is, for what it's worth. And so therefore, I kind of keep that neutral for myself. And so therefore, I would choose to wear basic colors. But I do use multiple colors. I don't use only one color. I use multiple colors. And you know, when it comes to my looks, I would be very, you know, I wouldn't pay too much attention to my looks as much. So that's my way of looking at it. However, Vivek has a very unique way of looking at his expression. So Vivek, why don't you share yours?
So I don't really use clothes to express any roles, but also my belief is that fashion does not have to show any particular gender.
Yeah.
It should not link to a particular gender. If anybody else wants to wear it, they can.
Yes.
So my everyday wear would be very functional, but during events and celebrations, I tend to dress a particular way, and you know, it has to be different, and I'd much rather have attention towards me.
And mine is the exact opposite. I do not want attention on me unless I want the attention on me. And so when I want attention on me, I will call everyone, I will scream, and I will get everybody to look at me. But apart from that, I don't even want you to notice that I am there. Even like a fancy function or like a wedding or whatever, I don't want to be known. I don't want to be seen by anyone. I want you to look at me and forget me. That's how I prefer. But yeah, I mean, I've seen him dressing up for the occasion the way he should. That's something I've noticed.
It's not too much, it's not too less, but it certainly has heads turning. That's what I would want to happen.
On a day-to-day basis, what do you wear and why?
On a day-to-day basis, it is very like, It's just, as I said, functional. It does what is needed. It's a solid black tee. It's a solid black trouser. So that's it's just like basics. I own all basic clothes.
And why all black?
Black because it's very, first of all, it's again the function, it's easy to maintain, and second, it is dark, but it's also like, I don't know how to explain it. It's not to be taken as, you know, black is a color for a morning. But I would rather, you know, wash them easily, and, you know, that's the main reason.
But you could go with all gray also. You could go with all red also. Why black? Why black?
The only reason is to maintain it. I do not want any stains on the shirt to be visible ever. So for everyday wear, it is purely functional. If it doesn't serve the purpose, I'm not gonna wear it.
Yeah, I can understand. Even my whole wardrobe is filled with black. My parents are just done with me. But yeah, like black as a color, it's very universal. I think that, you know, you can do so much. You can wear anything, just go out and, you know, so that people don't judge you because it's just black. Yeah. So,
inspired me to choose black was Chanel's LBD.
Oh, yeah.
I've seen the entire film of it, and I was like, it is very multifunctional. So it works in all places, everywhere.
Yeah, definitely. So what was the initial reaction of the society, and how is it now, like when you compare it?
I think that for that, Vishwa's mother has helped a lot. She was the one who has either silenced them or given them answers. And we just exist in front of them. The conversations are mostly dealt with by Vishwa's mother or my mother. So they handle it well. They are the ones who, you know, inform other people about our relationship. And they are the ones who actually get those awkward responses from people.
Yeah.
In terms of our family and immediate neighbors and people that are around us, I think it's my mom and I mean Vivek's mom, both her moms, they kind of take the lead in deciding how or what answer has to be given. When it comes to both of us, I think we just live a life which is based on companionship, based on mutual understanding, like any other couple would. And it's visible, like when you see both of us work together, like my chachi passed away last week, and I did not go immediately after my chachi's passing away. When the news came, it was Vivek and my mom who went first to kind of take care of like the house and the rituals and all that. I joined, I think, 2 days after. So even in a situation like this, where people might not have known him as my partner, but even before they knew him, they knew what he was doing there. So he was actively contributing to the ceremony. He was, you know, comforting people. He was making sure everybody had what they needed in the time of, you know, this sudden death that happened in the family. And so people's first memory of him was that of someone who's giving comfort to them. And it was only later that she introduced him as my partner or my husband. And I think that has constantly been our modus operandi when it comes to orienting people or talking to people. I know people will still have their own inhibitions. We know that they are going to still talk if they have to behind our backs, and they will laugh, all that. But at least from our side, we would like to do all that we can to accommodate them. Now, after that, whether they accommodate us or not, socially or in their hearts, that's a call that they can make themselves. Our job is to accommodate them, because that's what we expect from them as well. Whether they take that from, whether they want that or not, is completely their call. And I think that has been our way or our style of doing things from the very beginning, from ever since you and I started dating and then we got married. We have always been like that.
And so our idea is mostly like, our idea of giving answers is just, you know, you should come and witness us being together, and then you can pass your judgment or whatever if you wish to.
Yeah, I think that's...
It's really difficult. Like I've seen in college also, many of my, not many, but yeah, a lot of people I've seen, even the society or even the college staff, like the teachers are fine, but you know how the helpers and the college staff you have, they would give some judgments, or even, you know, us as like human beings or like normal teenagers, guys and girls. I've seen guys, you know, teasing and all. So one of my friend had an experience of someone passing him a judgment, and it really pinched him. So he came to me and he said that, you know, I cried and all. But I told him, you know, why did you cry? Instead of that, you could have just stood up and just said on his face, because that will make you strong. Don't just, you know, bury it, because it's very hard for, you know, coming out and accepting, because still his parents have not exactly accepted him or something. So definitely I can understand the struggles, and there must be more, but it is a challenge, a huge...
I think one thing that happens is that the moment you say that you are in love with somebody of the same sex or a different sex, but normally not a male-female conventional setting, immediately people jump to why it's unethical or wrong, because they simply look at it from the point of view of what's happening behind closed doors in their bedrooms.
Yeah.
Vivek and my argument to that is, well, what if we both are not doing anything with each other?
Yeah.
Is that okay then? Can we then be in love with, you know, not all love is expressed through physical intimacy or through sex. That's not the only expressed love. And if I am not physically attracted to anyone, but I'm romantically involved with someone, why is that such a big deal? Because in India, on the streets, you still see guys holding hands and like friends kind of like putting their arms around each other. And that's not something that is frowned upon or that is even questioned by anyone. So when you can be intimate with someone, you know, to a certain extent in public, and it's not considered wrong, why are you assuming that just because both of us are married, we both are having sex? Maybe we both aren't having sex. Why is so soch tumhari gandi hai ya meri gandi hai? Because I did not say I'm having sex with anyone. I'm saying I'm pure and pious, quote unquote. I mean, you can do any way you want to. So I think, at least with both of us, we are very mindful of our gender and sexual identity and roles, and we try to keep it neutral for each other and for people around us. However, I can totally imagine if, say, if I were in love with someone who identified as a trans person, and they feel good about themselves when they wear hangings, but they also have a long beard.
Yeah.
They wear hangings and they still put a big bindi. Now, I will accept that. And I would find that attractive in that person. But I know that that is something that other people would probably take a lot more offense. You know, they take offense of that. They will be like, oh, that's unnatural or that's wrong. And it is these distinctions that make it worse for a lot of people. So a lot of people say that Vivek and I are more heteronormative in the sense that both of us look very normal. We dress normally. We talk, act normally. So we don't really appear to be gay, whatever that means. And so therefore, I feel that to some extent, it is easier for both of us to exist. But the same thing, if it were, say, maybe another couple who were, say, maybe a transgender marrying another transgender or a transvestite marrying a gay man or any of that combination, it would be so difficult for them, because in our case, when we walk on the street, people don't really turn around and look at us. But for other people, it's even more stark, because people turn around and look and they comment and they stare, which is not something that we experience as much. Sometimes we do experience it, but it's still a lot limited. So that way, I think we both are lucky that we both found each other and, you know, things work for us, and our respective mothers are supportive of our sexuality. But at the same time, I know so many other friends of mine who have to go through that on a daily basis, just like your, you know, people, your colleagues, your friends, and what they have to go through. And yeah. I think that in India takes a lot of courage.
It is. And I don't think so. I mean, and even how we say we are modernized, and, you know, old generation are also getting modernized, parents and all. But I still strongly believe that even in further years, I don't think so. Things will change gradually. I mean, it's not picking up that fast. They are trying to understand, but at the end, they also have their back mind, you know, that no, we can't accept and all. Absolutely. But it just fits to understand. Yeah.
It is difficult, and it's even more difficult for people who choose to, for example, you know, if you see a man in a bindi or a man, you know, a man who puts on a bun because they've got that bun is called a man bun. Why can it not? Why can it? So as opposed to a woman bun, a bun is a bun, whether it's a man bun or a woman bun, a bun is a bun. Call it a man bun, just call it a bun. But even in those regards, there is such a stereotypical use of language to express, even in fashion. And I think if, you know, for example, up till I think maybe a decade before, shrugs was not something that men would wear in India. Hmm. And now you suddenly see a lot of straight men also wearing shrugs. You know, they wear these long shrugs. You know, and it became popular more with Ranbir, whatever. Even I don't know. I've seen that. And so I do remember when I was in school, college, it was considered a big deal. It was considered, you know, if you saw someone in a shrug, it was assumed that that person is girly, or only like people of a certain sexual expression, gender expression. They might end up wearing shrugs more than, you know, so if you're wearing a shrug, people would assume that, oh, you know, maybe you're into the same. If you're a guy wearing a shrug, maybe you're girlish. That's how people would look at you, which isn't the case now. So gradually, while fashion sense is changing, how do you normalize fashion also? How do you bring acceptance of people through fashion? So fashion, a lot of times people look at fashion, and I know that a lot of people look at fashion as something which is a head turner, you do fashion to attract other people. Fashion can do the exact opposite also, like in my case. Fashion can also do a mix of both. You know, it will only kind of make you aligned to only a group of people. For example, if I wear a kurta and a pajama and a tikka, and if I go out, go out in UP, it might, or Haridwar for that matter, more likely that I will have more people wanting to converse with me more openly, versus if I wear hot pants a vest kind of a thing, and slippers with shades, and if I walk on the street and ask somebody for directions, people are less likely to help me versus if I wear same person will get a different response based on what they're wearing. And I think breaking that or finding a middle ground in fashion where people can express themselves without it becoming a religious expression or a gender expression, that would be an interesting thing to see. People have tried that in the past. I think there are a few fashion designers who have tried it, who have tried to bring elements. For example, I still remember, I don't know the name of the, I think it was Rohit Bal. Rohit Bal, in the very beginning, when he brought in floral patterns into the shirts that actors used to wear at that time. This is 20 years back, 20, 25 years. It was a completely unheard thing. And the first time people saw it, they had a very, very strong reaction to it. But then it caught on immediately and it became like a big thing. And everybody, all men were wearing floral patterns suddenly.
Yeah, definitely. Now also they are.
Yeah. And so to see that shift in how fashion can allow for people to express themselves without it being a judgment call, can be a powerful force of reckoning that fashion can do, which language can also do. But I think fashion definitely has a much more stronger role in that, to play in that thing.
Yeah. And as you said, you're not really into fashion, but you choose to not be seen or be attracted. But if I asked you if ever, like you said, that if I want to get attracted, I would definitely wear attire which actually attracts people, right? So what is that attire which you want to express yourself, also your identity through that attire or the outfit you're wearing?
I look at the occasion more than my identity. So for me, what's more important is what's the occasion and how do I best suit the occasion. My mother has a saying which is khaiye man bhata pehniye jag bhata. Have you heard that? So my mother says that khaiye man bhata,
okay,
ye jag bhata.
Okay,
do you understand what it means?
Partially.
Khaiye man bhata, aapko jo acha lagta hai wo aap khao, aur pehniye wo jo jag bhata, jo baki sabko acha lage. So that is, and she kind of told that to me even when I was growing up. So if there is a wedding and if I have to dress like the older brother of my cousin brother, because I'm the eldest cousin in my family, then I will dress in a way that complements my cousin brother.
Yeah. So
in those cases, I would less focus on my own self and I would focus more on, because I would look at clothes more as a device or a tool to have the purpose that has been assigned to me socially, because ultimately we are all social people and we all have our own roles. So I would look at it that way. And so even when I'm going out, or even when I want people to look at me, only if that's the need of the hour, I need to be looked at, because if I'm not looked at, then whatever it is that I'm thinking of doing might get mostly affected. Only in that case will I choose to wear. So for those, I've got a set of very clear, you know, basic kurta pajama, kurta and chinos that I wear very often for those. And then I've got a few western semi-formal attire clothes that I have, coats and things. Depending on the need of the hour, I would wear that. But that's how I look at it. But I do know a lot of people in the LGBT community who will on purpose wear clothes which might have an element of shock, because they want to edge you to your discomfort, so that gradually you move towards accepting. So by going over, they are actually pushing you subconsciously to kind of make some acceptance. It's a very clever thing that people do. You know, for example, if all women decide to wear anarkali kind of frock, the skirt thing. So like, then maybe a gay guy or a transgender or someone of a different identity, gender expression or identity, will also wear that along with a kurta, just to kind of tick people off, you know, just to kind of tick people off. And I think that's interesting. You know, when that happens in front of me, I find that very interesting. However, because I have been given acceptance by my family, and because I've been given love by my family, and they've given some concessions to Vivek and me, I feel it will be unfair if I do not honor that love and acceptance that I've got by not serving them the way they want to be served, because they need something also. You know, for some people, they take it for granted. They say, you know what, their parents, they're supposed to accept you. I understand that, but I know pragmatically that might not be true, or that might not be correct. You know, psychologically, people are like that. You know, if you are different, and if you're so different that it's causing others to constantly fight on your behalf, then acceptance for them is much more difficult to give to you also, and to explain the same for others also. So we look at Vivek and I look at our roles for our family with a sense of duty.
Yeah.
We would allow for that duty to take over our identity at certain places out of love and respect for them and how much they understand. That's what Vivek and I have chosen to do. And it has been a very conscious choice that both of us have made. You know, we both have sat down and discussed it and said, you know what, for example, Karwa Chauth mein, Vivek always does Karwa Chauth for me. Now that's a very gender repressive thing to do, but it makes my mother happy.
Okay.
So he does the Karwa Chauth ki puja also, with like the entire thing of the passing of the kada and garba. He will cover his head and he will do that entire puja vagera, all that he will do. Although he knows that it's stereotypical, it's female, it's repressing females a certain way.
Yes.
It is a very negative message, you know. But even then he would do it, and I would let it happen simply because it makes my mother happy. Now, other people in my family see those photographs, they tend to like Vivek a little more. Because like, oh, so sweet. He's so sweet, you know. Bichara bhuka raha pure din Vishwa ke liye isne dekho, vrat rakha, kitta achha hai wo, kitte achche se. So, you know, then when we go for their wedding ceremonies or their anniversaries or anything like that, because they have seen us do that for my mother, you know, and they want something like that from their kids also, which they might or might not be getting. And so therefore, they are more endeared to us.
Yes, they definitely.
Bow a little more towards us because they've seen that sense from us as well. That is the interesting thing that I keep seeing again and again with my family, at least. And that, for us, is our idea of change. You know, we are just joining a school in Riverside. Both of us are joining that school. And both of us will be teaching. He will be teaching younger students like nursery, pre-K, K1, and I'll be teaching high school students.
Okay.
So got an openly gay couple in a school, both employed in the same school.
Yeah.
One person teaching younger kids and one person teaching the eldest of the lot. For us, even that is an act of resistance.
Yes.
So, you know, if I hide my identity today, I can very easily find a job which is probably going to pay me twice or thrice as much as what I'll be paid in this school. Same with, but we would choose to stay in this school simply because they accept us. And simply because by being there, we can go out and about and have conversations with students, parents of students, and society at large, of, you know, as an out and about gay couple who is married and who's working in the same school and is working with children. So we are, we are redefining or challenging a lot of those norms by bringing, by addressing those aspects more. And we are determined to do a very, very good job, both of us. We are determined. We will not give any reason for a parent or a child to ever complain about us. That is how good we'll be. We'll be better than all. Because see, you have to understand how a straight guy will look at it or a straight parent will look at it. A straight parent will turn around and say, ye Vishwa sir hai na, gay bhale hi honge, but yaar, padhate bahut achha hai. Unse baat karke achha lagta hai. This is what they will take away. If their child will do good in whatever subject that they are studying with us, they're going to go away saying that, you know, irrespective of what his gender identity or sexual identity might be, you know, Vivek sir was the best teacher he has had, or Vishwa sir was the best teacher my child has had. Now that's the narrative that we both are going after. We are interested in that because I think that is a much deeper level of change. You know, it kind of impacts people at a much deeper level than the external, outwardly dressing thing. So, you know, we are kind of looking at it that way. So,
okay.
You know, if that makes sense. You
should I think your net or my net is fluctuating. I'm not sure.
All right.
That's one example of setting an example in the society. And I think which, you know, by doing that, by teaching in school, that is one thing we actually need in school. Because until unless we are taught about this, we've never been taught about, you know, sex education or anything else about, you know, there's only male and female, not any other gender, which we should have been taught. And so that we don't, you know, As an individual, we don't find out on, you know, ourselves and our parents saying, no, this is not the right thing. Mm-hmm. But until unless the kids are taught from the beginning and the parents accept, that's something which is, you know, very mind-blowing. And
that's pretty much what we want to, you know, when Gandhi says, you know, I know it's a little cliche and, you know, the moment I say Gandhi, people kind of wince a little because of political opinions and all that. But, you know, Gandhi said, my life is my example. So if I just take that quote from him, you know, Vivek and I would like our life to be an example for our students. They should see both of us as a stabilizing factor in each other's lives. They, you know, the teachers in the school, the help and support staff in the school, like what you said, that, you know, there are certain, you know, admin staff or help and support staff, you know, to like look at, you know, people who are dressing differently a certain way. And the same thing happened to me just last week. I was in Ahmedabad last week and I went to the support staff of the school. They were all sitting together. You know, they had some free time. So they were all sitting and talking. And I asked them, you know, we needed a part-time help at home. So I told them that me, Vivek, I, and my small dog, all three of us are moving to Ahmedabad, and we need at least a 12-hour help at home. So somebody who can take care of the dog and kind of take care of the house. And so therefore, if you know someone, please let us know. And one of the help staff that I know very well, I've known her for several years now, because I've taught in that school before. She said, sir, aapki to shaadi ho gayi hai na. And I said, haan, meri shaadi ho gayi hai. Haan, to aapki wife nahi aa rahi aapke saath. And I said, aa to raha hai na, mera partner Vivek hi to hai, Vivek se hi to meri shaadi hui hai. And the moment I said that, she said, aisa thodi na hota hai. Ye to galat baat hai. She immediately said this. And I simply said, pehle aisa galat, pehle isko galat maante the, ab to aisa hi hota hai. She again said, haan, par aisa nahi hona chahiye. देखा होना चाहिए नहीं होना चाहिए नहीं पता, अब तो ऐसा होता है, मेरे केस में तो ऐसा है. एंड आई इन फ्रंट ऑफ एवरीवन वेरी पोलाइटली विद अ स्माइलिंग फेस, आई डिड नॉट मेक इट ऑकवर्ड फॉर माई सेल्फ और फॉर हर और फॉर एनी वन एल्स सिटिंग देयर. देयर वर अबाउट 12-13 पीपल सिटिंग देयर. आई डिड नॉट मेक इट ऑकवर्ड फॉर एनी वन देयर. आई जस्ट सेड इट वेरी मैटर ऑफ फैक्टली, अब ऐसा होता है, पहले होता हो नहीं होता हो मुझे नहीं पता, अब ऐसा होता है. और सो वेरी इमीडिएटली द मोमेंट शी क्वेश्चन्ड, दिस वाज माय रिप्लाई. सो जस्ट समथिंग लाइक दैट विल होपफुली अलाउ हर टू एटलीस्ट लेट पीपल लाइक मी लिव, इवन इफ शी डज. सो आई डोंट वांट हर अप्रूवल
टू लिव, ऑफ कोर्स
आई एम फाइन, बस don't come in my way. That's all that I'm saying. Don't come in my way. You do pretty much
what mind your own business. Yeah.
Your own business, bhai. You know, you think it's wrong. Bale, it's wrong. Fine. You enjoy it being wrong. I think it's right. I will continue to be this way. Please don't come in my way. That's all that I expect. If just this much can be accomplished today, hopefully, once she sees us contributing, you know, when her husband passed away, the same lady's husband passed away, all of okay. us, all the teachers pitched in money. I pitched the most amount of money. She doesn't remember. I do. Even at that time, I had it in my mind that the reason why I have to give more is because I want people to know that I am a giving person, so they know that they can bank on me, that they can trust me. So that in future, I know, you know, it kind of maybe sounds as though I'm bribing or whatever, but I know pragmatically that is what works. Tomorrow, if this lady comes and stands in front of me and says that, you know, aap galat kar rahe ho, hum nahi hone denge. The same lady, the one who said this, tomorrow comes in, at least I can turn around and say, hello, when your husband passed away and everybody was paying 100 and 500, I paid 5,000.
Yeah.
You know, so what complaints are you having? How am I not enriching your life by my presence? I understand that you have reservations. I can understand that completely. But if I am benefiting you, how can you turn around and say that what I am doing is wrong when it has got nothing to do with you? So that's the belief with which at least I try to operate. That's why I think for people who are, you know, it's very easy to cry and say, oh, we are, you know, treated incorrectly and it is wrong and we should get our rights and to, you know, stand on a podium and shout that we deserve our rights. It's very easy to do that. But people who are oppressed, people who are subjugated, I think they should be the ones who should give even more
to the society.
Society, so that there is reason for people to turn around and say, boss, what are you saying? You know, if this guy can do so much for people, and if this is the issue that you have, the issue is too small, too inconsequential in comparison to what he is giving as a value add to all of us. So what do you want to choose? Will you snub him and throw him out because of his sexuality? Or will you include him in your life because of the value add that he does? So if that's what I feel, at least. So every time I see people into activism talking about how they are treated unfairly, I understand that. And I am with them. I understand that. I was beaten by Vivek's parents when they found out about my relationship with him. Vivek's parents came to my house and they bit me. They hit me. I had bruises on my body like that. मेरे घर में ही घुस के मेरे को मारा था उन लोगों ने. So and but today, but at that time had I gone to police, made a police thing and made a big issue out of it, I would not be enjoying the relationship that I have with his family today. At that time, it took every ounce of resilience in my body to not fight back. I had really hold my hands back from hitting them back because it's instinct, right? And yeah. I was in the gym at that time. I was pretty strong. I could have shoved them out and screamed. I have a very loud voice. I knew even at that time that I can, you know, there were just three people. Two of them relatively old and one his elder sister. I knew I could, but I chose not to very, very conscientiously at that time because I wanted it to turn around. It took 2.5 years for his parents to turn around and accept both of us. But had I lifted my hand on them that day, had I hit them back in self-defense, I don't think we would have had this relationship with them. I think this is something that people forget. Why we need resilience or why we need to give more or suffer more is because it's the memory that you leave in front of other people that kind of allows for other people to see you a certain way.
Yeah, I agree with you, sir, because even I tell my friends, you know how I've seen in my college, some of the people who are gay, you know, I've seen that they're very, you know, I don't want to say it the way it is sounding, but you know, they would ask for sympathy, you know, like, you know, I am this. You can't say this to me. If I had a brawl with one of my friends who is gay. So he gave false accusations on me saying I bullied him for an entire year and I made his life miserable. I said, that's not how you go about it. Okay. And I apologize if I did something wrong. I didn't do anything wrong. I was just, you know, we just have conflicts and all. But I said, rather than sitting and, you know, giving false accusations or, you know, saying that, make me happy by standing up. Like, as in, take your own right and do something more kind or, you know, just make that person suffer. Who made you suffer, make him suffer by doing what you outshine in, what your talent or what you want to show people that this is who I am. I can, like, I have so many guts, I know I can bring you down in 1 second. Do that. That will make people more happy. And that will actually, people's thinking will change because they'll start accepting and they'll start, you know, saying that, okay, all the time we were wrong. This is way much more than what we judge. Because that's the same, you know, the quote, you can't judge a book by its cover. It's the same way, you can't.
Absolutely. And I think that applies to everyone. Unfortunately, we live in a world where activism has taken this very violent us versus them role. You know, I keep feeling that because I'm gay and because I'm in a married,
yeah,
extra legal, it's out of the legal bounds. My marriage to Vivek is still not something that that is valued, that is even given recognition. So, you know, if a girl marries a guy, they both have legal rights on each other. Yeah. Vivek and I don't have that right on each other. Our marriage is purely symbolic.
Okay.
Even with that, till we get legal rights to marry, civil partnership or right to marry, any of those, till we get to that point, it is our duty to give even more and ask for less, you know?
Yes.
Or maybe some people might say, give more and ask for more also. I'm fine with that also. As long as you are the one who's also giving.
Willingly, yeah.
Saying that, you know, I am gay, so you accept me, instead of turn the conversation.
Yeah.
Do so well at your work. Do so well at your work.
So that they can't speak about you.
Person cannot question you. You know,
yes.
You have to be a designer. Be a designer that is so kick-ass, that the other person cannot even stand in front of you. Khada hi na ho paaye tumhare saamne. Phir bolega. That is the answer that is enough. Uske baad usko tumko physical injury karni ho ya kuch bhi karna, that is anyway illegal. Wo ek insaan dusre insaan ko, ek insaan kisi janwar ko bhi nahi kar sakta. Agar hawa pai pe baat aayegi to bhai legal rights to hamare paas tab bhi hai, because we are still humans.
Yeah,
right. Ki violence, we can go to the court and we can address. But so that's beside. But in terms of the verbal abuse or discrimination that you face, and it doesn't matter. I mean, I know that there are a few schools who said no to me because when I, you know, interview rounds happened and they loved me for my work and my, the way I speak and what all of that. And the moment I told them, also, by the way, I am gay and I'm openly gay. I am HIV positive. And I'm openly HIV positive. And I am married to a guy. And I'm openly married to a guy.
Mm.
You know? And I am still a teacher.
Yeah.
So I'm all of these things.
And
all of these things are an important aspect of who I am. The moment I said that, it was like, oh, okay, that's very interesting. No, 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 we don't have any problem. We will get back to you. We will get back to you.
Yeah.
And they never got back to us. And I don't hold any bitter resentment or anger for those schools. Some of them are very popular schools in Gurgaon. I don't hold any, because I understand where they're coming from.
Yeah.
Some parents, some schools were kind enough to let me know the reason of why. They said that parents will not accept, especially because you are in high school. And they will feel that you will be a negative influence on their children because you are openly gay. And no parent wants their children to be gay. So you might have. And I was like, well, I understand that. I respect that. If that's a call you're making, your school, your rules, I am not going to come in the way. Although I know it is discrimination legally.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I also know the harsh realities of life. It's okay. The reason why you let go of me as a teacher in your school or as an administrator in your school or as a vice principal in your school is because you think there is a problem. I am coming to you and telling you there is no problem.
Yeah.
You're the one who's creating problem out of it. It's the same as how some people say that, you know, there are certain job interviews in which it's written only females accepted. Only female applicants can apply. Or only male applicants can apply.
Yeah.
It happens. If you go on to LinkedIn and if you see for principal's role, they will, in bracket, they will write only females apply.
Okay, that's weird.
That's weird, right? It still happens. And for them, it's like, haan, hamari marzi hai, hum ladka rakhe, ladki rakhe, tumko kya problem hai? That's how a lot of these people look at it. You know, or that, you know, we feel that a female would be a much better representative of our culture and our ethos. Why can a man not be? So those are things that, again, will take time for society to overcome. Till that, I think it's beneficial for everyone, especially for the LGBT community, to have a more optimistic, strong, competent view of everything, society, occupation, life. Same goes with your friends. I think same goes with you, for that matter. You are a female. You should know that. You know that. You know how females are treated in our country.
Yes, definitely.
And it's horrible, some of the things that happen to the female gender because of your sex. Some things happen to you. Therefore, all the more your responsibility, not just to be an amazing fashion designer for yourself and for your family, but for the entire society. You know, you can look at it as an opportunity. You can also look at it as a drawback. I look at it as an opportunity. Even if it's at my cost, I know that you should, you know, I mean, I don't know, but you can Google it if you want to. There is a research by World Economic Forum, which says that females in the same position and same job roles are paid about 10 or 15% lower than men in the same position, same experience. तुमको 100 रुपए मिलेंगे तुम्हारे पार्ट मेल को 150 ना यू नो एंड दैट्स अ रियल रिसर्च बाय वर्ल्ड इकोनॉमिक फोरम यू कैन गूगल इट यू कैन फाइंड आउट अबाउट इट एंड लुक एट हाउ दैट इम्प्लाइज सोशली इवन यू नो द पावर दैट अ मैन विल हैव इन टर्म्स ऑफ यू नो पे पैरिटी or expenditure, how much can you expend? A man can definitely, therefore, spend more money than female because you are giving him more money to spend. Same car. So you now that's absolutely incorrect, right? But
yes,
how our society is. And so therefore, for a female to rise to the position of Indira Nooyi, for example, and actually demand for men and women to be paid equal because she was not paid equal. I think that's a much stronger statement than Indira Nooyi standing today when she's 25 years old in front of the Supreme Court or the parliament and saying, I want equal pay for men and women. Instead of that board, I think it's much more impactful if she decides to make an impact, reach that level, and then say, you know what? Equal pay. We pay equal pay to all sexes and all genders, irrespective of their, as long as you work well, we pay you well. You know, now she had to go through all of that for her entire life. But if she could bring that change in Pepsi, that would be worth a story. That would be a more viable. Hopefully, in education, Vivek and I hope that in another 20 years, 30 years, once we are very old and I am completely bald and hopefully wiser than I am today, I hope that people can look at both of us, other gay people can look at both of us and be like, you know what, if they can make it in education, we can do better than them in education. If they could go this far in education, we can go even farther than that in education. Yeah. And I think that is what we are getting at. We want education to be a place where LGBT people could also participate. Because I think there is a lot that LGBT people have to offer.
Yeah.
Well, you know, women have so much to offer. You know, there is no role in which you can say that a woman will do lesser or less, will be less competent than man. There is no profession like that. Nothing in the world that is like that. Same goes for, because ultimately we are people. And that is something that we are hoping for in 30 years from now, hopefully 20, 30 years from now, hopefully sooner. I think if, you know, we still haven't figured out how to express that in our fashion sense, but we have figured out that by not expressing our identity in a certain fashion, by keeping it neutral, we are able to overcome certain
norms and
certain presuppositions, certain stereotypes. Simple. But at the same time, when I'm in my class, you know, I do all sorts of drama with my students. I am extremely girly. I act like a teenage American girl. Oh my God, what are you saying? I do. And then I do a proper masculine male thing also with them, depending on what we're doing, what we are studying. I bring in those elements. I bring my gayness into my profession as well. But I don't make it so obvious that people who are in their 50s and when they were growing up, they had no idea what LGBT was, but they should not feel offended and suddenly taken aback. They should be able to see me as someone who uses that as a tool to benefit other people than express who he or she he is or who they are. That's really my belief. But having said that, I know a lot of people. Some of them I have already shared the contacts to with you, their names. Yeah. They are all people who share who they are by how they dress also. And I completely 100% support and vouch what they do. I feel that's not my way of going ahead. That's just not my style, or Vivek's style for that matter. But I completely understand their style and I'm with them on that. I do not doubt that at all. I love when there is an extremely masculine guy who wears a long earring and has mehndi in hand. I admire that because I think that takes courage. I don't think that's my route. Very humble. I step back from it, but that doesn't it's anyway, their way is anyway less valid, or their way is the right way. I don't think that is the case. I just think that in education, I think it's important for us, from Vivek and I, to kind of keep a non-threatening appeal, actually penetrate and do work which is much more significant. And hopefully work will speak for itself.
Yeah.
That's what I feel I should be getting after. In fact, everybody should be getting after. Somebody who belongs to OBCST and comes from a village, while I think that, or a Muslim in India, because there is a lot that is happening which is anti-Muslim right now. Women, for that matter. I think it's all of those. And I think all of us have to, irrespective of what we wear.
Yeah.
Work has to speak for itself, man. Work has to speak. People have to. You also. You are not just every single day when you come to school, you are not college. You're not just yourself. You're not just Muskan Sharma from, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Sharma. You are Miss Muskan Sharma, who is a female in a country where women are subjugated, women are raped, women are abused. And your work is going to inspire other people, or so should be your aim. Your aim should be that my work is going to be so awesome that, women after me are going to remember me and they're going to be like, Muskan Sharma jaisa banna hai.
Yeah.
Won't that be awesome? That'll be epic, man. I think if you could do that for people who are coming after you, the best gift you can give to the younger generation after you is if they could turn around and say, oh, you know what? I admire Muskan Sharma's style, Muskan Sharma's approach to fashion. I think just like, you've got B.V. Doshi right now in architect. Similarly, if you could be that one person who kind of like shifts the focus, even for gender, for that matter. So if right now when you're looking at, people, if you could design attire, is gender neutral, kind of like study what does gender neutral attire mean in dressing, which is neither masculine nor feminine.
Yeah, unisex.
Yeah, unisex, correct?
Yeah.
But clearly picks up elements from both.
Both masculine, yeah.
Both masculine, feminine. So, if you could kind of build on that in a manner which is also Indian in some form or manner. Indian, not just from the sense of Hindu Indian, Indian India, which is pan India. I think that Chumbak has done that for merchandising. If you look at the design of Chumbak, they've really Indianness into merchandise, and that then has kind of spread out, and other people have emulated that. Suddenly, auto rickshaw became a cool thing to have at home, or your mobile cover can have an auto rickshaw, and that's considered. Yeah. Or a fat man with a big mustache will be your mobile cover, and that's considered cool now. But someone who turned around and said, there is currency, there is an Indianness, and that Indianness can turn into a currency. for me. How do I turn this Indianness into currency, simultaneously also propagating what Indianness is all about? It is this messiness, use of multiple colors, vibrant and dull kind of coexisting in the same place, someone in dhoti and someone in pants, and a girl in short skirt and a girl in proper burqa, all of them kind of coexisting in the same place, and they still kind of look as though they're all in place. You know, that craziness that kind of makes India what it is. You know, that was what he was going after, whoever designed. I think Fab India has done that to some extent for, I mean, of course, there were other houses, other companies also, but I think Fab India kind of brought the Indian traditional handlooms and
products. Yes.
You know, they kind of brought it out and kind of made it like the, not daily products, not things like an expensive sari or a Kanjivaram sari. I'm not talking about, or a silk expensive sari from South. I'm not talking about those. What they did was they just took cotton, khadi, they just took like real bare elements.
Yes.
And they turned it around into things which could be something that anyone could wear. And while they... Right? So same way, if there could be something. So if you could maybe, big challenge, if I were a fashion designer, that I would look for is if I could design clothes or design something which a homosexual teacher and an activist who's a body positive activist, both comfortably wear, both can actually carry or wear at the same time, and you know, while it might have certain elements which might be like a little offensive or a little brazen out there, the other elements kind of complement them in such a manner that it doesn't, you know, while it hits you, it doesn't offend you like that. You know, it stretches you but does not stress you, kind of.
Yeah.
Like, if that could be something that you could do, and if, you know, and if tomorrow I am going to school wearing the same attire that you've designed, and I've got a body positive friend like this guy that I shared number with you. He calls himself body positive cross-dresser. That's what he calls himself. I've shared his number. I'll share it with you again. Venkatesh. His name is Venkatesh.
Okay, I think he didn't reply.
I'll ask him to reply. But get after him, because you know he's an interesting character. Very different from how I am. But I still admire him for who he is. And if challenges, if both of these entities who coexist under the same umbrella of LGBT can wear your attire and feel a sense of community and oneness without it being
harming or tinging somebody
else.
Yeah.
My God, if you could crack that, no, you have cracked the human psyche of fashion. Ye crack kar liya na tumne, Muskan. You will crack everything then. This is the biggest challenge that I don't think anybody has even like thought of even overcoming right now. They're still looking at bits and pieces, you know?
Mm.
That's the bigger umbrella. My God, that's going to be powerful. That's going to be a powerful statement for, and being a woman who knows that women are oppressed. If you are doing that for another community which is oppressed, that then the story becomes even more powerful.
Yes, definitely. Because, yeah, women, like, we do have, problems and everything else. And most of the fashion designers are, you know, basically glued to female, male clothing. With the idea you gave, which is actually something, you know, no one has really put
that much
an effort.
So it's not, and even if you look at unisex attire, and design of clothes, from my limited understanding, even unisex attire is more bending towards male.
Yes, definitely. I've seen that.
And I kind of feel that problematic. And that's why a lot of people who are body positive, transgender, or people who consider themselves to be either transvestite, so a man who likes wearing women's clothes, they kind of move more towards bindi, alta, lipstick, all of that, instead of it being something which is in the middle part.
Yeah.
Because you're kind of showing that you yourself are in transition. And so instead of being one and embracing another, you are showing that you are, you know, you're showing where you are. You are in transition right now. Fashion is always in transition. More so for people who are Indian, either Hindu, Muslim, whichever part of country, you know, state you belong to, somewhere in the line of education, you know, so you're either highly educated or not educated or somewhere in between. Same goes with work. It'd be interesting to see how that plays for jewelry, which is for both men and women, or merchandise, or attire, shoes, anything like that. It'll be very interesting to see how that turns out. I feel that your teachers know, your design teachers at Pearl, they should genuinely like challenge you guys to with these kind of questions. Tabhi maza aayega. Tab tum log na pagal ho jaoge. Sir khujla, pehle to sir khujlaoge sare baith kar. Ki kya de diya. When you will start going deeper. And that's...
Yeah, let's talk out of the box.
Absolutely. When that happens, no, that's when real learning happens for you, because you will then get to learn about yourself also. The more you learn about others of society, the more you will see yourself in relation to them. And that will then inform not just your fashion choices, but also your life choices. That's a powerful mix of education that they can give you. I think they should do that. Do you know Prateek? Is Prateek, Prateek Kumar still in Pearl Academy?
I don't know anyone.
I'll ask. I've got a friend, Prateek. He, I think, was a teacher or is it?
Rajouri, because see, Pearl Academy has like so many campuses, but in Delhi, we have two campuses. One is in West Delhi, which is Rajouri Garden, and one just shifted to South Campus. Not sure where, near Saket or somewhere.
I'll ask him where, does he still teach, or if he does, because he's openly gay. And I think he, but again, he's a graphic designer. He's not a...
Probably then, yeah. So he must be in some communication course.
But I'll ask...
So why don't you join Pearl Academy? I mean, listening to your...
I'll be qualified for that. I'm not a... I'm a designer of education, not a designer of...
Like listening to you, it is so inspiring. I mean, the way you're talking and the idea you gave, which is actually, you know, none of the designers or even like a student, I have never thought about that. So that is something which is, I mean, you can totally nail, or, you know, I would love to have someone who is teaching us this.
Well, all in good time. I'll see. I don't think so far, with my interactions with Pearl Academy, fortunately, I've known some people in Pearl Academy. My impression of Pearl Academy was that they're very specific about what kind of teachers they're looking for. And I never looked at myself as someone who's joining there, because my forte really has been education and thinking and design thinking. Those have really been my my tools or my weapons in life. Yeah. But I mean, I can definitely, you can share, I mean, I'll share this video with you. You can share it with your friends.
Yeah.
If they are interested, I would be more than happy to come. I'd come, even if I come in as a person who can come in to talk or interact sometime, you know,
it there is like a visiting faculty, because I know one of my dad's friend's daughter, she had passed out from Pearl or something, but she came in for like, she came to my college for like a for a few months for visiting faculty and all, but I never got interacted with her in my college. But yeah, but definitely having you as a teacher would be a good experience.
झुक जियो, खूब खुश रहो, इतनी अच्छी अच्छी बात बोल रही है. See now, this is how I bring in my sexuality in conversations. You see, the entire time I did not bring it, and then I bring in once. One small smudge of
yeah. it,
and then I'll completely back off so that it doesn't seem offensive. You know, that's something no, I try to do.
But I'm not even saying it to brag, but like listening to you, and you know, it is so inspiring the way you said that your Vivek sir and you would, you know, start in a school and hope in future you can bring some change. But I can definitely see it. As in, like, you know, there is going to be a drastic change. And the students, of course, you're going to teach are probably the lucky ones. Because having a teacher like you would be something which is very amazing and unique at its own best. Like, you have all the qualities, as in, like, you are a teacher. And then I feel like maybe at one point you should also become a fashion designer. Because the ideas you're giving.
That's too much work, man. I will do so much. Tum log kitni mehnat karte ho, bhai. I have seen, and you know, fortunately, being gay, I've had the opportunity to meet a few fashion designers and people who are in designing generally, either in architecture or graphic or fashion. Man, the amount of hard work you guys have to do to name, you have to be at the right place at the right time with the right message.
Yeah,
make it big in fashion, in designing generally. Otherwise it's very difficult. So many who are producing and designing, so to speak, that to be someone who kind of, to become a B.V. Doshi, you have to really have a very keen insight of yourself and the world around you. Or the lady who designed a little black dress. If you, you know, I was... Chanel, right? Like even her understanding of herself, you know, and who she is as a person. Same with the editor of Vogue. What's her name?
Anna Wintour.
Look at Anna Wintour also. Such strong individuals, man.
Like, she has some class. I mean,
वो class पता है self awareness से आता है, मुझे ऐसा लगता है. I feel that class, that level or that class, you know, the way you, because it's less to do with what you wear, it's more to do with how you carry yourself.
Yeah.
And how you carry yourself is directly related to how much you know yourself. You know, what are the moral conundrums that you can overcome on a regular basis? How deep have you gone in understanding yourself and others? It kind of allows you to kind of carry yourself a certain way. You know, you carry yourself a certain way because you're like, bro, I know my shit. You don't have to, don't bullshit with me. I know my shit. You know, that attitude or that thing can only come if you've really gone deep into your subject, you know.
Yeah,
feeling that's where designing is as much about self-reflection and design thinking. It's also about thinking about yourself. So when you took this topic, one element that I feel your teacher should have added should have been, how did this journey or this topic impact your view of the world that you live in? How have you evolved as a person by virtue of going through this journey of designing that you are currently embarking on? Every single project that you take, there should be at least, how many marks is this particular project for you?
This is just an activity as of now. Like the assignments haven't started yet.
But I would say if this one was for 50 marks, I would definitely put at least another 15 marks for your own personal journey, because sometimes even though you don't come out with a very good product, so to speak, your journey is extremely powerful. And that might not help you in that particular product, but it will help you in the next product that you design. And I think that's articulating that is a key skill that all designers need. Like B.V. Doshi once said that when he looks at a space, the first thing he looks at is where the light comes from. It was such a beautiful thing that he said. It's in one of his talks. He says that, you know, when he's designing a space, the first thing he looks at is the source of light. Where is the light coming from? Because ultimately, everything that you see is because of light falling onto the surfaces and onto you. It's because of the interaction between the light and your eyes that you see space. Otherwise, not exist for you. And so therefore, the first thing he does every time he looks at design is designing architecture, a space, is at the interaction of light with the elements of the space. I heard it, and I kid you not, I heard it many years back. I think it's a YouTube video of his. It blew my mind. I had goosebumps all over my body when I heard it. I was like, boss level. This is boss level. No, I don't know many architects who think like that so much. You know, or they talk like that as a matter of fact. He said it as a very matter-of-factly thing, which completely unheard of by the other architects and other talks and other people that I've met. So similarly, you know, in designing, whether it's merchandise or whether it's fashion, I think it's important to kind of see that element of depth of perspective, which I think is powerful. All right, I have a class in 10 minutes, so I will have to go to that.
Yeah,
thank you so much. And thank you for praising me so much. You're very sweet.
I mean, you're worth the praises. Why wouldn't someone praise?
I'm glad you
like. Request, if you could share your pictures, the wedding pictures, if you don't mind.
I'll be happy to share. You can ask anything we have. It's yours. You can take it. You can use it whichever way you want to. It's not going to be very significant. We have not done anything which is very important. But, you know, I think it'll tell a story for sure. So yeah, definitely. Yeah. And I'll share this link with you as well of this recording.
Okay.
All right. Oscar.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye, sir. Thank you so much, sir.